Respected Chairperson, Dr. Mohammad Naik, respected Dr. Shoaib Syed, my co-speaker, Brother Athar Mohammad, my respected elders, and my dear brothers and sisters. I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Which means, peace, mercy, and blessings of Almighty God be on all of you. This is the same greeting with which Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he had greeted his disciples. As we find mentioned in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verse 36, where Jesus said, Shalom Aleikum. This is a Hebrew quotation, which means peace be unto you. Same as we Muslims say, Assalamu Alaikum, which means peace be upon you. The Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes it an article of faith for its followers to believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of Almighty God. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern-day Christians today do not believe. We believe that he was the Messiah, translated as Christ. We believe that he gave life to the dead by God's permission. We believe that he healed those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. In fact, no Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. In this book, the glorious Quran, there are no less than 15 chapters that speak about this mighty messenger of Almighty God. The titles which are given to him are Masih, which means Christ. He's called as Ibn Maryam, which means the son of Mary. He's called as Abdullah, the servant of Allah. He's called as Ruhum Minhu. Almighty God says that he is a spirit proceeding from Almighty God. He's called a word from Almighty God. These are all respectable terms given to this mighty messenger of Almighty God. Moreover, he is called with his name no less than 25 times in the glorious Quran. Now let us analyze what was his name. The name that is used is Isa. This was his name. In Hebrew, it's Esau. In classical, it's Yehoshua. But then the early Christians, they Latinized this name by adding J and S to it, and it became Jesus. Peace be upon him. But the name that was given to him by Maryam alayhi salam, by Mary, was Isa. Peace be upon him. And what about the name Christ? What is the meaning of the word Christ? The word Christ is also translated from the Hebrew word Messiah. In Arabic, it's Masih, which means anointed. What the Christians have done, early Christians, they translated this word Messiah into Greek. It became Christos. Christos. But the word Christos, it was too long for them. So they chopped off os and it became Christ. This is how we get the word Christ. Now people think that it's a unique name. But believe me, this word Christ, it appears in the Bible various times in the Old Testament. But of course, the word that is used in English is anointed, it's not Christ. Original in Hebrew, it's Messiah. For example, if you read, it is mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 45, verse number 1. It speaks about Christ, Cyrus. Cyrus was a pagan king. In the Old Testament, we find priests and kings, they were anointed by Almighty God in consecration to the position given to them as officially appointed. We find in the book of Genesis, chapter number 31, verse number 13, it says a pillar is anointed of God. Pillar. Pillar is anointed of God. Further, if you read, it is mentioned in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 4, verse number 3, it says that the priest who is anointed, if he commits sins, and it continues. Further, if you read, it is mentioned in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 8, verse number 10, it says tabernacle was anointed. And all those things which were in the tabernacle, they were anointed. If you read, it is mentioned in the book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 2, verse number 10. It says that Almighty God has exalted the horn of his anointed. In all these Old Testament references, if you substitute the word anointed with the original Hebrew word Messiah, it will read Messiah Cyrus, Messiah Pillar, Messiah Tabernacle, and on and on. But believe me, all these references, anyhow, they do not belittle Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. He was anointed for his position as a reformer amongst the Jews. Let us analyze the position of Mary, the mother of Jesus, peace be upon him. In this Quran, there is one complete chapter in honor of the mother of Jesus, peace be upon him. One complete chapter, chapter number 19, called as Surah Maryam, chapter Mary. In 66 books of the Protestants and 73 books of the Roman Catholics, you will not find a single chapter which is honored in the name of Mary. We find in the New Testament books named after James, Timothy, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and on. But there's not a single chapter which is named after Mary. The story of Jesus, peace be upon him, and his mother Mary is mentioned in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 42 onwards. The Quran says, وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. And behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اسْتَفَاكِ وَتَحَّرَكِ وَاسْتَفَاكِ عَلَىٰ نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ, that the Lord hath chosen thee and purified thee and chosen thee above the womb of all nations. The Quran says that Mary was chosen above the woman of all nations. Such an honor given to Mary is not to be found even in the Christian Bible. She is chosen above the woman of all nations. The Quran continues, Ya Maryam uknuti wasjudi warkai marrakin. O Mary, prostrate thyself and bow down in prayer with those who bow down. This news is given to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Almighty God. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was an Arab and he is speaking to other Arabs. And in spite of the ongoing enmity and hatred between these two races, you know, Jews and the Arabs, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he is telling his Arab brethren in the most sublime way, whether they believed him or not, that a Jewess, a lady from his opposition, was chosen above the woman of all nations. Can anyone explain this? Why would an Arab, he would honor a lady from his opposition? That too, belonging to a race which had been looking down upon the Arabs for past 3,000 years, as even today, they look down upon the Arab brethren. The answer is simple. He had no choice. He was not speaking from his own desire. As the Quran says in the next verse, Zalika min ambail ghaibi nuhihi ilaik. This is the part of the tidings unseen which we reveal to you, O Messenger, by inspiration. Had Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam been the author of this book, Glorious Quran, he would have not failed to include in this book, along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, his own mother Amina, his beloved wife Khadija. But no, he couldn't do this because he had no choice. This cannot be his handiwork. This is the word of Almighty God himself. Let us analyze the birth of this mighty messenger of God, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 45 says, Iskalatil malaikatu ya maryamu. Behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبَشِّرُكِ بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّنْهُ, that Allah give thee glad tidings of a word from him. إِسْمُهُ الْمَسِيحِ إِسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمُ, that his name shall be Christ, Jesus, the son of Mary. وجيها في الدنيا والآخرة ومن المقربين held in honor in this world and the hereafter and in the company of those who are nearest to Almighty God. The birth of Jesus, peace be upon him, is also mentioned in the Bible. Similar situation in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 1, verses 34 and 35. And when this glad tidings was given to Mary in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 1, Mary reacts. She says, how could this be, seeing I know not a man? In the Quran too, Mary reacts. In Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 47, she says, Kalat Rabbi anna yakulli waladum walam yamsasni bashar, that, oh my Lord, how can I have a son when no man had touched me? Meaning physically, sexually. In the Bible, she says, how can this be, seeing I know not a man? Meaning physically, sexually. If you compare these two verses, the verse from the Bible and the verse from the Quran, you'll find there is hardly any difference. You know, both these sentences, both these verses have identical meaning. There is only a difference in choice of words. But both mean same thing, believe me. And if any Christian, he happens to come across this verse of the Quran, just in English, without Arabic text, in a form of a sheet or a paper or a pamphlet, without Arabic text, he would think maybe he's reading from the King James Version if he hasn't seen one. Or he'll think perhaps he's reading from the New International Version if he hasn't seen one. Or maybe he'll think that he's reading from the RSV, the Revised Standard Version, if he hasn't seen one, and on and on and on. But he will never be able to make out that he's reading from the glorious Quran. Because the words have the same meaning. But if you look at the respective replies given to Mary in the Bible and the Quran, they reveal the difference. What did the angel say to Mary according to the Bible? The angel said, as mentioned in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 1, verse number 35, he said that the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Now what is one to understand from this verse? I'll just tell you what Billy Graham, he understood. Billy Graham, the famous evangelist from USA, when he was speaking in front of the audience of 40,000 people in King Park, Durban, he dramatized this. He said, and the Holy Ghost came and impregnated Mary. This is what he did. Holy Ghost came and impregnated Mary. Contrast this, the reply given to Mary, according to the glorious Quran, the angel says, Kala kazalika Allahu yakhluqu ma yasha, that even so, Allah created what He willeth. Fa iza kaza amran, whenever Allah decrees a matter, He but says, Kun fa yakun. He but says, Kun fa yakun. Be and it is. See, if you compare these two replies given to Mary, according to the Quran and the Bible, they reveal the difference. There's a difference of chalk and cheese. I hope you all understand the meaning of chalk and cheese. There's a world of difference. They are poles apart. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to create a Jesus without father, He merely has to will Him into being. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to create a million Jesus, He merely has to will them into existence. This is the concept of birth of Jesus Christ according to the glorious Quran. That Almighty God, He willed Him into existence. Now this word be, it is not anything new that I am telling you. You know, if you read the Bible in the Old Testament, I'll just remind you, in the book of Genesis, chapter number 1, it says, and Almighty God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God said, let there be vegetation, and there was vegetation. Let there be light and light. Be vegetation, vegetation. Now I leave it up to you, which version of the birth of Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him, will you prefer to present it to your daughter or your sister? The biblical version of the birth of Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him, or the Quranic version of the birth of Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him? The glad tidings further continues. The angel said to Mary, وَيُكَلِّمُ النَّاسَ فِي الْمَهْدِ وَقَالَ, and He shall speak to men, Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him, He shall speak to men in childhood and in maturity. Now this is the good news which is given to Mary, that your son, your child, Jesus, peace be upon him, he shall be speaking to people in childhood and maturity. Of course, when people, they are mature, they do speak naturally, normally, but he will be speaking in his childhood as an infant. And this prophecy we find fulfilled within months, as we find mentioned in Surah Maryam, chapter number 19, verses 27 to 33. Since the circumstances of the birth of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, they were peculiar. Peculiar because the Quran doesn't speak of Joseph the carpenter. There is no mention of Joseph the carpenter in the glorious Quran. And there is no genealogy of Jesus Christ in the Quran, as we find in the Gospel of Luke and Gospel of Matthew. Between these two, they have given more than 100 fathers and forefathers to this mighty messenger of Almighty God. The person who did not have any father, they have given more than 100 fathers and forefathers to this mighty messenger of Almighty God. The Quran doesn't give Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, any genealogy, nor does it speak about Joseph the carpenter. So since the circumstances of the birth were peculiar, so she had retired to a remote place in the east. This is what the Quran says. And after the birth, she returned. She returned carrying the baby, the child, little infant, in her arms. And when she came to her people, they said, "Kalu ya Maryam, O Mary, truly an amazing thing you have brought." These people, the people around Mary, they knew very well that this lady, she's not married. Knowing that she's not married, they were shocked. "Where did you get this child from?" Trying to insinuate that this is an illegitimate child. Now what was she to do? What was she to do? Would they believe in her explanation? I'm asking you, would you believe in your daughter's explanation? Suppose your daughter, she tells you that, "Daddy, I heard some voices and now this child is born." Will you believe? What was she to do? She merely pointed to the infant, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. To the little child, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Because she knew that this is not an ordinary child. Ask him. Now the people, they reacted. They said, "How can we speak to one who is just a small child in the cradle? How can we speak to him?" But by a miracle, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he spoke. He said, "Kala inni Abdullah, indeed, I am the servant of Allah. Atani al-kitab, I am given revelation, waj'alna nabiyya, and I am made a prophet. And he has made me, Almighty God has made me blessed wheresoever I be. And he has enjoined on me prayer and charity as long as I live. And he has made me kind to my mother and not overbearing or miserable." This is what Jesus said, peace be upon him. "Wassalamu alayya yawma walidtu wa yawma amutu wa yawma ubasu hayya." So peace is on me the day I was born, the day I die, and the day I shall be raised back to life again. This was the first miracle Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he performed to defend his mother from an unbelieving audience. As an infant, he performed this miracle. I would like you all to compare this first miracle of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, with the first miracle Jesus performed according to the Bible. You know what miracle he performed? It was a marriage feast at a place called as Cana. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and his disciples, they had gone there. As we find mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 2, verses 1 to 10. Jesus, peace be upon him, and his disciples, they had gone there. And they ran short of wine. So Mary, the mother of Jesus, she comes to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, saying, "Help them." Because she knew that my son is not an ordinary son. He has those miraculous powers. He has those spiritual powers. So she came and said, "Help them." And Jesus reacted. Jesus said, "Woman, what have I to do with thee? my time is not yet come. But then persuaded, he turned water into wine. And since that day, wine is flowing like water in the Christendom. This was the first miracle Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, performed according to the Bible. Many people think that the word Christ is synonymous with the word crucifixion, because they keep on preaching Christ crucified, Christ crucified. Therefore, this word Christ has to do something with the word crucifixion. But believe me, this is a misconception people have. The word Christ has nothing to do with the word crucifixion. Nothing. But then this is what is bringing salvation to the Christians. Because we find mention in one of the books of St. Paul in the Bible, in 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, verse number 14, St. Paul says that if Christ be not risen from the dead, then your faith is vain. Your preaching is also vain. That means for you to attain salvation, for you to go to paradise, Christ has to rise from the dead. Regardless of what your good deeds you do. You see, this is what they tell us Muslims, that you Muslims, with all your prayers, with the mark on your forehead, with all your charity, with all your fasting, you Muslims will go to hell. Because you don't believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he rose from the dead. They tell us all your deeds are like filthy rags. Filthy rags. I am asking you a question. Did Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, teach this? Did he ever say, for you to attain salvation, you have to believe that I shall die on the cross for your sins? He never said this. In fact, he said, you should keep the commandments. Imagine Almighty God killing his own son, as the Christians call him, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, his own begotten son on the cross for the sins of others. It is as though a king, when some criminals are brought in front of the king, rapist is brought in front of the king, a murderer is brought in front of the king, and all these criminals, they are brought in front of the king, but the king, instead of punishing these people, he calls his own son. He calls his own son and he hangs him on the cross for their sins. And then he says that you believe that my son died on the cross for your sins, you will be saved. You are scot-free. Go. I'm asking you a question. Is this logical? This is injustice. Why should king kill his own innocent son for the sins of others? But this is what brings salvation to the Christians according to St. Paul. But this is not what Jesus Christ taught you. Believe me. If you read, it is mentioned in the Bible. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 7, verse 21, Jesus said, not all those who say, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but those who do the will of my Father. And what is the will of the Father? Jesus said, peace be upon him. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verses 17 to 20, that think not that I have come to destroy the law of the prophets. I have not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till the heavens and the earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass away from the law till all be fulfilled. And whosoever therefore breaks and teaches men to do so, one of the least commandments, he shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. And whosoever keeps them and teaches men to do so, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For verily I say unto you, unless your righteousness exceed the righteousness of Pharisees and scribes, ye shall by no way enter into the kingdom of heaven. When Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was asked by a person in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 19, verses 16 and 17, that which are the good things that that man was supposed to do in order to attain salvation, in order to enter paradise. What did Jesus, peace be upon him, say? Did he say that you believe that I shall die on the cross for your sins? He said that if you want eternal life, keep the commandments. If you want to enter paradise, keep the commandments. Simple. Now my Christian brothers would say that you Muslims, you speak so much about Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, then why don't you Muslims follow Jesus Christ, peace be upon him? Didn't Jesus say that no man cometh unto the Father but by me? Let me remove this misconception that we Muslims, we claim to be better followers of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, than the Christians. Just for instance, I would like to know, how did Jesus pray? Peace be upon him. How did he pray? Did he pray by clasping his fingers and kneeling down? You know, Christians say, you Muslims, what an unusual way of praying. You fall down on your faces. Believe me, this is how we pray. Because Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he too prayed in the similar way. As you find mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 26, verse number 39, it says, and Jesus, peace be upon him, he took a few steps forward and he fell on his face and he prayed to Almighty God. This is how Abraham, peace be upon him, prayed. As we find mentioned in the book of Genesis, chapter number 17, verse number 3, it says, Abraham fell on his face and he prayed to Almighty God. This is how Moses and Aaron, they prayed to Almighty God. As we find mentioned in the book of Numbers, chapter number 20, verse number 6, that Moses and Aaron, they fell on their faces and they prayed to Almighty God. May Almighty God's peace and blessing be on all his messengers. This is how Joshua prayed to Almighty God. As we find mentioned in the book of Joshua, that Joshua, he fell on his face and he prayed to Almighty God. And this is how we Muslims too pray to Almighty God. As far as modesty is concerned, you find the Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 30, that say to the believing man that he should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. Similar message given even in the Bible. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he said in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 27, that you have heard that it had been said to them of the old times that thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh at a woman to lust after her, he hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was circumcised. And even we find in the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis, chapter number 17, Almighty God said to Abraham that every child, every male child should be circumcised. And this covenant of mine in the flesh of your foreskin will be an everlasting covenant for all those who come, for all your descendants. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was circumcised on the eighth day of his birth. This is what Gospel of Luke, chapter number 2, verse 21 tells us. And we Muslims too, we circumcise our male children, but the Christians don't. Pork. What does the Quran say about pork? The Quran says, in no less than four different places, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173, in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 3, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 145, and Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115, Hurrimat alaykumul maytatu waddamu walahmul khinziri wama uhilla ligharillah bi. That forbidden to you for food are dead meat, blood, flesh of swine, and all that on which any name besides the name of Almighty God has been invoked. What about the Bible? Does the Bible prohibit eating the flesh of swine? How many Christian brothers are aware of this? You know, all the priests and pastors who preach to the congregation in the church, with due respect to all of them, hardly any priest or pastor tells his congregation that you should not eat pork because the Bible forbids eating the flesh of swine. Let me quote to you, it is mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 14, verse number 8. In the book of Leviticus, chapter number 11, verses 7 and 8. In the book of Isaiah, chapter number 65, verses 2 to 5, it says, swine, though it divided the hoof, it cheweth not the cud. Of its flesh thou shalt not eat, nor shall it touch its dead carcass, for it is unclean for you to have. Eating the flesh of swine is not allowed according to the Bible. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he never ate pork. The Muslims too, we don't eat pork. But the Christians, they love pork. What about alcohol? The Quran says in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 90, Ya ayyuhal lazina amanu, O you who believe, innamal khamru wal maisru wal ansabu wal azlamu rijsum min amali shaitan. That most certainly intoxicants and gambling, dedication of stones, divination of arrows are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from them that you may prosper. We find having alcohol is discouraged in the Bible in no less than two different places. In the book of Proverbs, chapter number 20, verse number 1, it says, wine is a mocker, and strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. We find in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 5, verse number 18, it says, be not drunk with wine. Suppose today, in his second coming, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he comes, and any Christian happens to see Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and if he calls out to him saying, Jesus, Jesus, first of all, he is not going to respond to you, because his name was not Jesus. But even if he responds through some miracle, and if you tell him that Jesus, peace be upon him, come to my home, the question is, what will you feed him? Will you give him pork? Believe me, he never ate pork. He will be most comfortable in the house of a Muslim rather than the house of a Christian. There is a special position for Christians in the glorious Quran. I would like to conclude my talk by quoting the verse of the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specially speaks about the Christians. Allah says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 82, وَلَتَجِدَنَّ أَكْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَلَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. That the nearest to you, O Muslims, O believers, in love, will thou find those who say, we are Christians. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ مِّنْهُمْ كِسِّسِينَ وَرَهُبَانَوْا وَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. Because among them are men devoted to learning, and they have renounced the world, and they are not arrogant. وَإِذَا سَمِيُوا. And when they listen, مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ. What has been revealed to you, O Messenger, that is the Holy Quran, تَرَى آيُونَهُمْ تَفِيدُ مِنَ الدَّمِي. Thou shall see their eyes overflowing with tears. مِمَّا عَرَفُ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. For they have recognized the truth. يَكُولُونَا. They say, رَبَّنَا, our Lord, آمَنَّا, we believe. فَاكْتُبْنَا مَا الشَّاهِدِينَ. Write us down among the witnesses. With these words, I conclude my talk. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.
My question is addressed to Brother Suhail Baghdadi. Brother, is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been mentioned in Bible? Or, I mean, if by chance Jesus, peace be upon him, prophesied Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Jazakallah.
Sisters pose a question that is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied in the Bible? And especially, did Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, ever prophesy about the advent of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Yes, sister. The Bible does prophesy about the advent of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read, it is mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy in the Old Testament, chapter number 18, verse number 18. Almighty God, he said to Moses, peace be upon him, he said, I shall raise them up a prophet from amongst their brethren, like unto thee. And I shall put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. Now in this prophecy, Almighty God is saying to Moses, peace be upon him, that the prophet will be like you. I shall raise them up a prophet from amongst thy brethren like unto thee, like unto you, O Moses. The Christians, they say this prophecy refers to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. But if you see, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is more closer to be like Moses than Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. For example, Prophet Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was born miraculously without any male intervention. Whereas Moses, peace be upon him, and Muhammad both, they had natural births. Both had father and mother, whereas Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he had only mother, no father. Both Moses, peace be upon him, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were kings. Kings means they had authority to give capital punishment. But Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, as mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 1, verse number 11, it says that he came unto his own, but his own received him not. Jesus Christ said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 18, verse 36, that my kingdom is not of this world. Further, if you compare both these messengers of Almighty God, Moses and Muhammad, they both fought wars, battles. Whereas Jesus Christ, he did not fight battles. Both Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Moses, peace be upon him, they married and they had children. Whereas Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he did not marry. Both Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Moses, they died natural deaths. But Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was raised up alive. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, according to the Quran, he did not die. Even according to the Bible, he did not have a natural death. They say that he was crucified on the cross. So in all these aspects, we see that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and Moses were not same, but Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Prophet Moses, they were same. Further, the prophecy reads, "And I shall put my words in his mouth." The prophecy says, Almighty God shall put his words in the mouth of that prophet. And we know that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he actually uttered whatever was revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. "And he shall speak in my name." And all the chapters of the glorious Quran, they start with a beautiful formula called as Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, in the name of Allah, most gracious and most merciful. The prophecy reads, "I shall raise them up a prophet from amongst their brethren like unto thee." It says that the prophet will be from the brethren of the Jews, as Moses was speaking to the Jews. And we know that way the Jews and the Arabs, they are brethren of each other. They are cousins. So this is the prophecy which speaks about the advent of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to further substantiate that this prophecy refers to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you read the Bible with a concordance in the New Testament, there were three distinct clear questions which were asked to John the Baptist. People, they came to John the Baptist. It is mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 1, verses 19 onwards. People came to John the Baptist and asked him, "Are you the Christ?" He said, "No." "Are you Elias?" He said, "No." "Are you that prophet?" And he said, "No." Who is this that prophet? If you read the Bible in the concordance, we find a footnote written that this prophet refers to Deuteronomy 18:18, which I just quoted before you, that I shall raise them up a prophet from amongst their brethren. If this prophecy refers to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, then why would there be three distinct questions asking, "Are you Christ? Are you Elias? Are you that prophet?" This clarifies that even the Jews at that time, they were expecting a prophet other than Prophet Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and other than Elias. Moreover, even Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, in the New Testament, Jesus did prophesy about the advent of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you find this mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 16. Jesus said, "I shall pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter. I shall pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter who will abide with you forever." Now this is the prophecy. In fact, if you go to Greek, the word is used parakletos. For this word comforter, the original word is parakletos or paraclete, which means an advocate or a counselor. But whatever it means, even if you take as comforter, as has been translated, the word comforter, the Christians say it refers to the Holy Ghost. That this is not Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this refers to Holy Ghost. But Jesus Christ, he also said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7, that "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the comforter shall not come unto you. For if I depart, shall I send him unto you." That means the arrival of the comforter is conditional. For the comforter to come, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he has to go, he has to depart. It is as simple as that, that the comforter and Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, they cannot be present simultaneously. But we find that the Holy Ghost was present at that time. We find the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 1, verse number 15. It says, "John the Baptist shall be filled up with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb." It is mentioned in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 1, verse number 41. It says that Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. We find in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 1, verse number 67. Again, it speaks about Holy Ghost being present over there. Holy Ghost was present when Jesus Christ was baptized. And Holy Ghost was helping Jesus Christ to do all the miracles. If you read the Gospel of John, chapter number 20, verse 22, Jesus Christ had already presented Holy Ghost to his disciples. He said, "Receive the Holy Ghost." Imagine, Holy Ghost was present there. So how can this comforter be Holy Ghost? Moreover, the word "another," "I shall give you another comforter," the word that is used is not heteros. the word that is used is allos. For another, the Greek word that is used is allos, which means another of the same kind. That means another of the same kind, the kind of Jesus Christ, flesh and bones, not of a different kind. For different kind, there is a word called as heteros, another of a different kind. And we know that no Christian imagines, you know, in his mind that Holy Ghost and Jesus Christ are of the same kind. Jesus Christ was flesh and bones. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also was flesh and bones. Moreover, there's a prophecy in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verses 12 to 14. Jesus said that I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he shall guide you into all truth. He shall not speak of himself. Whatever he hears, shall he speak. He shall show you things to come. He shall glorify me. He shall testify of me. See, you find this word, he mentioned again and again and again in this prophecy. Christians do not refer to Holy Ghost as he. Again, the word that is used, the Greek word, and he shall not speak of himself, but whatever he hears, shall he speak. For this word hears, the Greek word that is used is echo and lelio, referring to hearing organ and speaking organ, that is ear and mouth. But the Holy Ghost is a spirit. Holy Spirit doesn't have ear, doesn't have mouth. So this prophecy also refers to none else but Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I hope that answers the question, sister.
My question is to Suhail Baghdadi. I just want to know the denomination in the Christians, Jehovah's Witness. Do they believe in Trinity? And where they do derive the word Jehovah from?
Brother has posed a question that he would like to know about Jehovah's Witnesses and whether they believe in Trinity and where do they derive this word Jehovah from. As far as believing in Trinity is concerned, brother, the Jehovah's Witnesses, they do not believe in Trinity. And they have derived this word Jehovah. If you read the Old Testament, we find the Old Testament in Hebrew, YHWH. In English, it's YHWH, which they have added vowels to, and they made it Yahweh or Yehovah. And after that, as I said, that even the name Isa was Latinized by adding J, again they added J to it and it became Jehovah. So this is how they get the name Jehovah. Moreover, the Jehovah's Witness, they also believe that Jesus died on the cross for their sins. Though they do not believe in Trinity, but they do believe that Jesus died on the cross for their sins. And these are the most active Christians. As far as preaching Christianity is concerned to others, you'll find these people, Jehovah's Witnesses, they are visiting houses of Muslims, knocking at the doors and saying, receive Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, as your personal savior. The most active amongst the Christians are the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Christian missionaries. I hope that answers the question.
My name is Asraf Ali Abdullah Haq Sheikh. I am a teacher. My question is to Suhail Baghdadi, brother, that I would like to know that Islam has to say about original sin, junah.
Brother has posed a question that he would like to know what Islam has to say about original sin. First, I would like to explain to you what is original sin. According to Christian doctrine, original sin is the sin that was inherited by people after Adam and Eve, may Allah be pleased with them, they committed the sin. What was the sin? We find this story mentioned in the book of Genesis, chapter number 3, that Almighty God, he said to Adam and Eve, that eat whatever you like from this garden, as they call Garden of Eden. But the only thing you should not eat is the fruit from the tree of knowledge. This is the tree from which you should not eat. But then it says that Satan, he took form of a serpent and he came and he deceived Eve. This is what the Bible says. And after that, she went and she tempted Adam and they both ate the fruit. The Bible says, Almighty God said that if you eat from this tree, you will die. But Satan came and said that if you eat from this tree, you will surely live. And believe me, after they ate the fruit, they did live. So here we find Satan is correct and Almighty God is proved wrong. Nauzubillah. But then later, Almighty God comes walking and asking, Adam, where are you? Now this is the time Adam realizes that he's naked. He's not wearing clothes because he has gained the knowledge after eating the fruit. So Almighty God is asking, Adam, where are you? Have you eaten the fruit from that tree? So Adam said, the woman that you gave me, she gave me that fruit. Trying to say that it was Eve, may Allah be pleased with her, she tempted Adam to eat the fruit. And because of this, the whole humankind is still date born in sin. And Almighty God said to Eve, that you woman, you shall multiply in conception. And in pain will you give birth. As though pregnancy, it degrades woman. As though this is a punishment given to woman. The Quran, it speaks about the story of Adam and Eve. In various places, the Quran says in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verses 9-27, Adam and Eve, they are mentioned more than a dozen of times. But there's not a single verse of the Quran which singles out Eve, saying that it was Eve that tempted Adam to eat the fruit. The Quran says both of them disobeyed Almighty God. But the Bible lays the blame only on Eve. And it says that pregnancy is as though it's a punishment. The Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 1, that respect the womb that bore you. Quran says in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 14, that your Lord has ordained unto you to be kind to your parents. In travail upon travail did your mother bear you, and in pain did she give you birth. That means pregnancy uplifts woman according to Islam, does not degrade her. So the Christians say, since Adam had committed the sin, we all are born in sin. I am asking you a question. Did Adam, peace and blessings be upon him, did he ask me before eating the fruit? Did he take my permission before eating the fruit? If he had asked me, and if I had given him permission to eat the fruit, then I would have been responsible for that. When Adam did not take my permission, I didn't give him permission, you didn't give him permission, how can we be held responsible for the sin that Adam had committed? Moreover, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is of forgiving, most merciful. He had forgiven Adam alayhi salam after he committed the sin. Adam alayhi salam repented, he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did forgive Adam alayhi salam. Moreover, this concept of original sin, that sins are inherited, is even against the Bible. This is taught by the church. It is the church that teaches you that you are born in sin. But what does the Bible say? The Bible says in the book of Ezekiel, chapter number 18, verse number 20. It says, the soul that sinneth shall die. This is the portion which my Christian brothers often quote, the soul that sinneth shall die. But they do not continue. The verse does not stop here. It still continues. It says, the son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. Father shall not bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him. The wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. If son cannot bear the iniquity of the father, iniquity means sin. If son cannot bear the iniquity of the father, how can we all be born in sins? We are all sons of Adam alayhi salam. How can we be born in sins then? If sins are not inherited according to the Bible, if the son cannot bear the iniquity of the father, how can we be born in sins? The verse continues, but if the wicked turns from all the sins that he has committed and does that which is right and lawful, then he shall not die. He shall surely live. That means any person, if he commits sins, if he repents to Almighty God, he will be saved. He does not have to believe that Jesus died for his sins on the cross. This is what the people say, that since Adam alayhi salam had committed the sins of the world had become so great that it was difficult for Almighty God to forgive us without Almighty God himself coming down on this earth and dying for the sins of the world. So this concept is even against the Bible. I hope that answers the question, brother.
My question is posed to Brother Sohail. Is it that a prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, permitted wine? And if he did, why is it the exactly opposite of what Islam preaches?
Sister has posed a question that, is it like prophet Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he permitted wine? And if he did, then why does Islam teach exactly opposite of it? And of course, we find in Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 90, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that you cannot have alcohol. No wine. You see, sister, there were certain things at the time of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, which he wanted to implement, but the time was not there. The first miracle Jesus performed, according to the Bible, he converted water into wine. And as I said, since then, wine is flowing like water in the Christendom. But the Christians, unfortunately, they take exception to the verse from Proverbs chapter 20, verse number 1, which says wine is a mocker. And book of Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 18, which says, be not drunk with wine it discourages having wine. So it's a bit contradiction in terms that Jesus, one place making water into wine, another place Bible is discouraging having wine. But Jesus did say in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verses 12 to 14, that I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he shall guide you into all truth. He shall not speak of himself. Whatever he hears, shall he speak. And he shall show you things to come. He shall reprove the world of sins. As Brother Athar Muhammad said, that the real miracle is that without any miracle, you transform nations. Only on the authority of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the glorious Quran, we Muslims have produced the biggest community of teetotalers. That is, we don't imbibe alcohol. I know there are some Muslims who do have alcohol, and they can go to the extent of drinking the non-Muslims under a table. But overall, as a whole, Muslims have produced the biggest community of teetotalers. Since that time, there was no time for Jesus, as Jesus has always been telling his people, that you men of little faith, you evil and adulterous generation, you perverse generation. So at that time, he felt that maybe these people are not going to accept what I'm going to tell them. So it's a gradual process. And ultimately, we got the final revelation in Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 90, which says, O you who believe, most certainly intoxicants and gambling are an abomination of Satan's handiwork, so you should stop it. If it is the Holy Ghost, which is mentioned in the Bible, that the Comforter, the one who is going to come, he shall show you things to come. I am asking you, till date, why hasn't the Comforter, the Holy Ghost, stopped the Christians for having alcohol? Believe me, it is the wine which is causing deaths on the highways, on the roads. It is because of wine that families are disturbed. So it is the wine which is causing so many problems. We have the statistics of America. We come to know that every 12th person in America is committing incest. That is, he is cohabiting, he is sleeping with his close relatives. Father-in-law sleeping with daughter-in-law. Brother sleeping with sister. And so on and so forth. This is what we call incest. And most of the time, those who commit all these sins, they are intoxicated. They are drunk. If Holy Ghost is the one which has been mentioned as the Comforter or the one who is going to come, I am asking, why didn't the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, stop the Christians from doing this sin? I hope that answers the question, sister.
Yes, sister.
Assalamu alaikum. As per the concluding verse given by Brother Suhail, verse Surah number 5, verse number 82 of the Holy Quran, he mentioned about this verse that among, and you will find the nearest in love to the believers, those who say we are Christians. This is because amongst them are priests and monks and they are not proud. So the question is, can we apply this to people who are found even of date? Are there any such people?
Sisters posed a question that, as I concluded my talk by quoting a verse of the glorious Quran from Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 82, which says, وَلَا تَجِدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَلَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. That the nearest to you, O Muslims, O believers, in love, will thou find those who say we are Christians. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ مِنْهُمْ كِسِّسِينَ وَرَهْبَانَ وَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. Because among them are men devoted to learning. They are not arrogant and they have renounced the world. Faiza samiu, and when they listen, ma unzila ila rasul, what has been revealed to your messenger, that is the Holy Quran, tara ayunahum tafizu min ad-dami, thou shall see their eyes overflowing with tears, mimma arafu min al-haq, for they have recognized the truth. Yakuluna, and they say, rabbana, our lord, amanna, we believe, faktubna ma shahidin, write us down among the witnesses. So sister is asking me a question, does this verse stand good, hold good even today? Are there any Christians today about whom this verse of the Quran says? Yes, sister, even today, there are those Christians, after they listen to the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they embrace Islam. These are the Christians who respect the value and virtue of the Quran, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be the messenger of Almighty God, and the Quran to be the word of Almighty God. And after the verses are presented to them, they do accept that, O Lord, we believe, write us down among the witnesses. The Quran says in Surah Al Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 110, Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. You are the best of people evolved for mankind. Ta'muruna bil ma'rufi wa tanhauna lil munkar. Because you enjoin what is right and you forbid what is wrong. Fatu'minuna billah. And believe in Allah. ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم. If indeed the people of the book had faith, it would have been best for them. من هم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون. Because among them, there are some who have faith. But most of them are perverted transgressors. So there are people like, I appreciate Brother Danny Abdullah, he just came forward and he said that he is a Christian, but he worships Allah. This is the thing that I like about him. These are the Christians about whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and I believe Brother Danny Abdullah, you don't believe in Trinity as well. That's it. Such are the people about whom the glorious Quran says that among them are people who have faith, but most of them are perverted transgressors. I hope that answers your question, sister.
My question is to Brother Sohail. According to the Bible, Jesus Christ died on the cross while being crucified. But according to the Quran condemns the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Then how did Jesus Christ die? Whether it was a natural death?
Brother has posed a question that according to glorious Quran, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he did not die on the cross. He did not die. And according to the Bible, Jesus was crucified. So what is the fact? The glorious Quran, it does say in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 157 and 158, وَقَوْلِهِمْ إِنَّا قَتَلْنَا الْمَسِيحِ إِسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمْ. And they say, the Jews, they say in boast that we killed Christ Jesus, the son of Mary, Rasulullah, the messenger of Allah. وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا سَلَبُوهُ. They killed him not, neither did they crucify him. وَلَكِنْ شُبِّيَ لَهُمْ. It was only made to appear to them so. وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ اَقْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ. And those who differ therein, they are full of doubts. إِلَّا تِبَازًا. They are full of doubts. Without any certain knowledge. وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ يَكِنَا. For surety, they killed him not. بَرَّفَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah raised him up unto himself. So we believe Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did not die on the cross. I am asking you, who could be so emphatic, so dogmatic, so uncompromising in rejecting a dogma for faith than this, the glorious Quran? This could be none else but the all-knowing, omniscient, almighty God himself. For the Muslims, we believe that Jesus did not die on the cross. He was not crucified, nor was he killed. If the Christians had believed the Quran to be the word of God, the problem would have been solved 1400 years ago. Today, there wouldn't have been any problem regarding crucifixion. But what do? The Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 111, وَقَالُوا لَيَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا وَنَصَارَى. That they say that none shall enter paradise unless he be a Jew or a Christian. تِلْكَ مَانِيُّهُمْ. These are their vain desires. Kul hatu burhanukum in kuntum sadikin. Say, produce your proofs if you are truthful. And the Christians, they have produced their proofs. They have translated the Bible in more than 2000 languages of the world. Now what are we supposed to do? Are we going to accept this proof of the Christians, hook, line and sinker? No. Allah says, Kul hatu burhanukum in kuntum sadikin. Say, produce your proofs if you are truthful. It is presupposed that after the proof is given to you, you are going to cross-analyze the proof. Now the crucifixion is based on the Bible. We can prove from the Bible that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was not crucified. However, the explanation from the Bible, it may not be the Islamic perception, but still we can prove from the Bible that Jesus did not die. Just for an example, the Christians, though they quote several verses of the Bible saying that in the Old Testament it is mentioned that Jesus will die for the sins of the world, though there is no clear-cut prophecy, there is no name of Jesus mentioned anywhere, I am asking you, what did Jesus say? Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verses 38 to 40. People, Jews, they came to Jesus and said, Master, we would like to see a sign from you. We would like to see a sign from you. Show a sign. Show us a miracle. And Jesus said, Ye evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. No sign shall be given to you but the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Now what is the sign of Jonah? Book of Jonah is only a couple of pages in the Old Testament. And every Christian who has gone to Sunday school, even a child, knows what is the story of Jonah. This is the prophecy that Jesus Christ is making. We find in the Old Testament that Almighty God, He sent Jonah to deliver the message of the truth to people in Nineveh. But Jonah, he instead of going to Nineveh, he goes to a place called as Joppa. But while he was traveling on the boat, there was a storm. There was a storm, thunder and storm. So these people, since the people around him, they were superstitious, they said, there is somebody on this boat who has done a certain guilt. He has committed certain sin. And because of this, we are suffering from this storm. So they cast lots, you know, head or tails. How we have today, head or tails. Let's see who is that guilty person. Through head or tails, we'll find out who is that guilty person. And Jonah was the guilty person. But Jonah, he volunteered. He said, you throw me in the water. So Jonah volunteered. And these people, they threw him in the raging sea. And in the sea, a big fish, in fact a whale, it comes and swallows Jonah. And then the whale, he takes him around the ocean. And then later, the whale vomits Jonah on the shore. Now my question is, how was Jonah when he was thrown into the water? Was he dead or alive? Alive. When the whale came and whale took Jonah into its belly, was Jonah dead or alive? Dead or alive? He was alive. When the whale, it took him round the ocean, was Jonah dead or alive? Alive. When Jonah prayed to Almighty God from the belly of the whale, was he dead or alive? I say yes, he was alive, because dead men do not pray to Almighty God. And then fish, it went on the shore and it vomited Jonah on the shore. Was he dead or alive? Alive, 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 alive. He was alive. Jonah was alive. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that for as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Jonah was alive for 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale. So even Jesus ought to be alive for 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. If you ask a Christian that in the tomb, how was Jesus? Was he dead or alive? They say he was dead. Believe me, if he was dead, the prophecy is not fulfilled. Prophet Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he has to be alive in order to fulfill the prophecy. But there are certain Christians who come and say, you know, actually this prophecy, it refers to the period aspect. That 3 days and three nights, that is very important. It is not as Jonah was, so shall the Son of Man be. It is the aspect of the period, 3 days and three nights. Again, if you consider the aspect of the period, we are told from the Bible that Jesus was crucified on the day, which was the day? Friday evening, just one day before Sabbath. And since it was Sabbath, the next day, they were in a hurry. And the evening, they took him down from the cross. This is what the Bible says. And they put him in the tomb. So Jesus Christ was in the tomb Friday night. Saturday, full day, he was in the tomb. Saturday night, full night, he was in the tomb. Sunday morning, when Mary Magdalene, she goes to the tomb, she finds that the tomb is empty. Jesus is not there. So how much is the time? It's Friday night, one night. It's Saturday day, full day, Jesus was in the tomb. It's Saturday night, full night, Jesus was in the tomb. But on Sunday morning, Jesus is not there. So it comes out to be two nights and one day. No tricks, two nights, one day. What did Jesus say? For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. So even the time factor, if you consider, it comes out to be wrong. So we have to say that this refers, for as Jonah was, so shall the Son of Man be. Jonah was alive, even Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, has to be alive. I hope that answers the question.